Thank you so much for the bell music this morning as we enter into our time of worship with As the Deer Panteth for the Water, a melody of a great song in our church life. And they're going to be playing here another minute for an introit with a familiar melody as well. There is a balm in Gilead. So I'll get to my announcements quickly so we can hear their musical offering. But glad to see you this morning. I'm Doug Albertson and have the pleasure of being a part of church staff here, as well as welcoming you and inviting you to join us for a cup of coffee, where you can go down and help us celebrate Doris Lorenz's 94th birthday today. She's right there. 94 years old. Well done. You look great, and we're glad you're here, and especially glad that you're a part of our church family. We're glad you're all here, and hopefully you will come by and be a part of our social hour, which is in our fellowship hall. If you're new visiting, it's down to the right. If you're not sure, hopefully somebody will gather you up and take you down with you. And the coffee's on us this morning, okay? In the life of the church, of course, are the morning announcements. Several things I just want to bring to your attention. The first is this afternoon at 12:30. It says 12:15 in the bulletin, but I think by 12:30 we can actually get there. And that is the reception for Lindsay Kerr's ordination ceremony. She received her orders on Friday night in a grand and glorious ceremony of ordination, along with seven others. It's quite a proud moment for those of us at the longstanding Methodist to watch the younger folks who have committed to the call to serve the church. And at this point in their lives, they've gone through all of the steps necessary to become ordained pastors in our church. And we're so proud to see her, and some of our former pastors were there, of course, and good friends. We had a good crowd from First United Methodist Church Santa Rosa down there when we got to cheer for Lindsay Kerr when she was announced. And the laying of hands was very moving, and the washing of feet was especially powerful for me to see. And I just can't give you enough feeling about the heart that I experienced at that Friday night ceremony there in Burlingame. If you didn't get to be there, you can come after church at 12:30 at Stony Point. People said, what do we bring? What's the deal? It's basically a coffee, cookie reception, but you can bring a card, because those of us who know Pastor Lindsay know that she's a woman of the word, and she loves to read your sentiments. So if you would be just able to just write her a few words of congratulation, what you feel this morning about her having achieved that great success, I know she would appreciate it a lot. So see you out there at 12:30. And then this is Vacation Bible School Week. Woo, it's finally here. Elizabeth Walton is in front, just still chewing on her fingernails. But, no, you're calm, she says. Well, bravo. We are ready, she says. They set up tomorrow. They could always use help in the setup if you want to come at 10 o'clock tomorrow. Kids arrive on Tuesday. It's just a joyful time. How many of us in our lives remember Vacation Bible School, either as a kid or as a helper? We'd love to see you out there if you'd like to be out there with us this week. And then lastly, just remember that we are gearing up for a golf tournament in August. We're going to talk a little bit about that each Sunday, just to help prod you into finding a group of guys, gals, people, whoever, mix it up. We'd like to get 100 people. 25 foursomes would be a great goal for us to reach. And we're on our way, and we started registering last Saturday. If you're thinking about it, think no more. Sign up today. Okay, there you go. There's my announcements. The rest of it is in your bulletin to read, and please do take time to do that carefully. And now, as we enter into our worship, once again, we invite our bell players to share their introit with us.
Thank you.
God, we do indeed come here taking time to be holy. We give over to you our thoughts, our cares, the burdens that we've brought in, the joys that we share, to be in this blessed place, this community that so is connected to one another, and it's so much, it means so much to each of us. Bless us now as we share the word, raise our songs, and as we prepare for the week ahead. Amen. Oh, sorry, boys and girls. Shirley Cheel's here.
Rush on up.
Coming up from Appalachia.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Well, it's me and... I got a mic. I have a mic, Chris. Yeah, yeah. I have a mic and I have an audience, but it's just me. Okay, well, here you go. All right, well, oh, we got a few coming, I think. Maybe. Ah! Bravo. Well, this morning I have a book called The Invisible String. And I thought I'd read just a small part of it, but I think it kind of ties in with the things that we think about when we're at church. So I'll start right here, The Invisible String, and it's by Patrice Cartz. Lisa and Jeremy, the twins, were asleep one calm and quiet night. Suddenly it began to rain very hard. Thunder rumbled until it got so loud that it woke them up. Mommy, Mommy, they cried as they ran to her. Don't worry, you two. It's just the storm making all that noise. Go back to bed. But we want to stay close to you, said Jeremy. We're kind of scared. Mom said, you know, we're always together no matter what. But how can we be together when you're out here and we're in bed, said Lisa. Mom held something right in front of her and said, this is how. And she went like this. Okay. Can you see it? It's the invisible string. Rubbing their sleepy eyes, the twins came closer to see what Mom was holding. I was about your age when my mom told me about the invisible string. I don't see a string, said Jeremy. You don't need to see the invisible string. People who love each other are always connected by a very special string made of love. But if you can't see it, how do you know it's there? Asked Lisa. Even though you can't see it with your eyes, you can feel it with your heart and know that you are always connected to everyone you love. Now, here's the question. Who else are we connected to, do you think? We're connected to God, you're right. And of course, this book doesn't talk about that part. But it does go on to talk about how the children asked if they were connected to their cousins and the ballet dancer down the street that they knew and the astronaut in the sky and all of those things. And of course, the mom did say that they were connected. And then at the very end, this is what it says. Within a few minutes, they were asleep, even though the storm was still making the same loud noise outside. As they slept, they started dreaming of all the invisible strings they have and all the strings their friends have and their friends have and their friends have until everyone in the world was connected by invisible strings. And no one is ever alone. And this book ends there, but I wanted to talk to you a little bit about how, if we're connected to everybody and we're connected to God, I just want to let you know that sometimes when we think of being connected to God, it's hard to imagine, isn't it? It's kind of like having this invisible string that we don't see anything, and so it's really hard to think about that. But sometimes when I'm at church, you know, and I realize that everybody's kind of different, there's a group of people that sometimes I'm around and they come to church and they bring everything with them when they come. You know, they come because they're hungry, but they bring all their possessions, and some of them bring their bikes. But they also come because they're lonely and they want a friend. And I think that's important. Then they also want to be closer to God. So sometimes when we think of these people, we think they're kind of on the outside of things. They're kind of like outsiders. And we have to remember that in the very beginning, when churches first were established, there were a lot of outsiders, that churches were made up of outsiders. And so when we think about these outsiders in our community, we have to remember that God loved them just like he loved the very first early Christians that were considered outsiders at the time. So what I want you to think about when you think about this book, because I hope you sort of remember sometimes these books, is that we have an invisible string that goes to God, but God has an invisible string that goes to everybody. So through that string, we're actually connected to everybody through God's love. So that's a kind of a little different way of thinking about it. I know the pastors have been talking about that. But anyway, let us pray. Dear God, perhaps thinking about the invisible string will help us to remember that we are connected to everyone through you. Help us to share our love with all people, those we do not know very well, those in need, even those we perhaps do not like. Let us remember that perhaps these people are sent by God to teach us something, to teach us how to be an amazing example and share your love. Amen.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading comes from 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 through 15. Elijah flees from Jezebel. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with a sword. Then Jezebel sent a message to Elijah, saying, "So may the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life like the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then he was afraid. He got up and fled for his life. He came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah. He left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a solitary broom tree. He asked that he might die. "It is enough now, O Lord. Take my life, for I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the broom tree and fell asleep. Suddenly, an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." He looked, and there was a cake at his head, was a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. He ate and drank and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came a second time, touched him and said, "Get up and eat. Otherwise, the journey may be too much for you." He got up and ate and drank. Then he went in the strength of the food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God. At that place, he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks into pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake, and after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire, and after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I've been very zealous for the Lord, God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant and thrown down your altars and killed your prophets with a sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness in Damascus."
Thank you. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable and honorable to you. You are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. When you open the morning paper, you hit different headlines. And the papers each week cover different kinds of issues that we are dealing with in our day. Today's happens to be the plight of shelterless more visible in the city. Every day when you pick up your paper, you might look at a headline or look at an article that's talking about some issues we're facing. And the question we might ask ourselves as people of faith is, what is God's will and what is God's purpose in light of this situation? Today, right now. And you can go through the paper and ask that question about all that is going on right now in our city, in our personal lives, in our world, and ask the question, what is God's word for us in regard to this? And when you ask that question, you'd be asking a prophetic question. The role of the prophet is to help us to know what God's word is for now, for this time. And the prophetic role of a community is to live out that, a response to that word that addresses a particular circumstance that we face in your personal life, your family life, our city, or our world. We're going to have a series this summer on the prophets, and I've discovered there's a lot of misunderstanding about the prophets and the role of prophetic ministry, and there's a lot of just the unknown about the prophets, and so I have a couple of goals I hope we can accomplish this summer. One is that you will become at least familiar with six prophets. We're going to get six different prophets, and I hope that you'll just learn some things about them. As you might learn about people in this congregation that we are in fellowship with, we also are in fellowship with the communion of saints, those who've gone before us, especially those we read about in the Bible. And I hope you'll come to know and to like or even dislike some of the people that we meet in the scriptures that are part of our family as well. We just finished a series about life together, which in many ways is about our priestly role, how we find connection with God and each other. Community, life together, being a community of faith. Now we're going to talk about really our prophetic role. We are both priest and prophet, as Christ is prophet, priest, and king, so he gives us those same ministries in the world. Our priestly ministry is to be together with God and each other, communion. But we have a prophetic role as well, which is to know God's will and to live God's will in specific circumstances of our day. And so we're going to look at growing with the prophets during these several weeks together. And I want to just spend a minute talking a little bit about that role of the prophet, because some people just think a prophet is like a fortune teller, you know, who sees the future. And that's not really an accurate description of a prophet. A professor once told me in our class, he said, prophets don't as much foretell the future as they forthtell the future. In other words, based upon what we know about our faithfulness or lack thereof to God, we can expect these things to happen. And there is talk about the future, but it's a forthtelling of whether we're living according to God's will or way or not. And so forthtelling is a better way to look at it. One of the problems people of faith have sometimes is that we look at the scriptures, and we look at the scripture as looking at what God has said. Yes, indeed, God has said many things. And primarily we understand what God has said through the life and death and resurrections and teachings of Jesus of Nazareth, of Christ. But we also see what God has said in different times and places and circumstances throughout the Bible. And through that, we see there are certain rules that God has given us. There's principles we can glean from that. But sometimes we stop there. We say, well, if we can figure out what rules or principles God gave us in the past, we learn those rules and principles, and then we seek to apply them to the present. Well, that's not quite right. It's more like learning to understand someone else's voice. If I, if you were all to be talking at once, and I wanted to pick out Doug's voice out of all the voices that were speaking, I'd be able to do that if I had spoken to Doug in the past and know what Doug sounds like from hearing him in the past, or knowing the kinds of things that Doug says typically, right, from in the past, right? And then if we were all speaking at the same time, if I had some familiarity with Doug's voice in the past, I might be able to pick it out and respond to it in the present. That's kind of what it's like with God. We live in a noisy world. There's noise always in our head. There's voices and messages and things from the television, from our parents, and our tapes playing. There's things going on. We hear constant noise. Even if there's complete silence, there's noise going on in our head. There's voices speaking to us about this and that and the other thing. And certainly as we know how God has spoken in the past, we might be able to pick out how God is speaking now. That's the prophetic role. That's what the prophet's able to do. Thus says the Lord. Not thus said the Lord. You see? Thus says the Lord now for this decision, for this moment, to make this act. That's the prophetic role that we all share to some degree, and that we all are called upon sometimes to speak as we discern it. So we read the scriptures and we understand how God has spoken, and particularly how God has spoken to specific circumstances and times and places. Because if we can figure out how God spoke contextually then, we might be better prepared to hear God, what God's saying now. God's not going to say something completely contradictory to what God has said, especially what God has said through Jesus. And so we have some way of understanding that. Does that make sense? The role of the prophet is not to foretell the future. It's not to just apply some rules or principles. It's actually to hear how God is speaking now. For this issue, for that issue, for my life, for your life. What's God saying now? Thus says the Lord now. Wouldn't it be disappointing if you were wanting to have a friendship with someone, a relationship with someone, and they get to know you, and they know about your past and some things you've said in the past and something you've done in the past and what your values are and what you believed. And then as you're right by their side, wanting to have a relationship with them, they ignore you. Instead, they just remember what your values are and what you thought and what you said, and then they act with you guessing what you would want to do because they know what you used to want to do. God is like that in our midst, wanting to communicate and have conversation and engagement with us. And sometimes we ignore God's living presence because we're thinking about what did God say in the past, what rules did God give us, what principles did God give us that we can apply in the present. Well, that's fine, but what's God saying now based on all that? Thus, the prophets are so important to our faith, and the prophetic role in the community is so important to our faith. We're going to look at some of the prophets, and we've got these fun little prophet cards for you to take when you leave. You know, just a worship committee was talking about, you know, what are some ways we can just remember what we're talking about? And so the cards have a little way of remembering each prophet and some things the prophet experienced in life. Pick up one of these as you leave today. It'd be fun to remember all of that. In our mission statement, we talk about growing, loving communities of faith centered on Jesus. The whole series on Life Together was about that part of the statement, what that looks like. It says also in that statement that we are expressing ourselves through personal spirituality and social responsibility. Now, instead of those just being a slogan or words, those two things really come together beautifully in the prophets. The prophets have a direct and powerful relationship, personal relationship with God. And that relationship then is expressed socially in the community, how the community is to live together. We find no dichotomy between personal and social holiness. What else he talked about? They're one the same, really. And we see that in the prophets especially. Introduction concluded. Elijah, our first prophet to look at. Now, in order to understand a prophet, you're going to need to bear with me for a moment. You have to understand a little bit about context, because a prophet speaks specifically to a time and place. It's a word for now. And so it's important, it helps a little bit if we know something about the world that the prophet enters in. Now, in your devotional this week, if you follow Monday through Friday, you will actually read almost everything in the Bible about Elijah. It's only a few chapters from 1 Kings 17 to 19 and chapter 21, and then part of 2 Kings. And so if you want to follow that, you'll read almost everything about Elijah in a few chapters by reading about one chapter a day. I'll summarize that for you in a minute here anyway. But Elijah bursts upon the scene, and it's about 864 B.C. Now, the way I orient myself very roughly is this. And again, bear with me if you're not really a history person. You need to kind of understand some kind of context. It helps. It does. Believe me, it helps. It does. Helps. Really. Abraham around 2000 B.C., you know, roughly. David about 1000 B.C., Jesus, zero. So it's about 1,000 years between Abraham and David, roughly. Don't hold me to it. Roughly. In between Abraham and David, King David, there is Moses, probably 1400 B.C. So you got Abraham, you have Moses, you have David, you have Jesus, kind of 1,000-year periods. After David, King David, you have a period, now this is important, in which the kingdom divides. Now, if you're going to understand the prophets, you need to understand a little bit about this divided kingdom, whether you want to or not, okay? So I'm going to force it down your throat. Two kingdoms, okay? Under Saul and David and Solomon, there's one kingdom. After Solomon, it divides into two, north and south. And it really helps to orient yourself when you're reading the prophets to know where you are and to whom they're speaking. The north is called the north. It's called Ephraim. It's called Israel. All the same place. The south is called Judah. So when you're in this period, you're talking about Israel, you're talking about the northern kingdom. And the king divides into two. The northern kingdom is wiped out in about 722 B.C., and the southern kingdom is wiped out in about 586. Most of the stuff we have in the Bible comes from the southern kingdom's perspective. Even though stuff is happening in the north, it's kind of like, you know, remember what happened in the north so it doesn't happen to us here. The northern folks were not faithful. And so Elijah appears in the north, right, in about 864 B.C., and he arrives and during the time of the northern king Ahab. Now, Ahab's father, who was the king, made a political decision. You ever heard of monarchies, of royal families making marriages for political reasons? That ever happened? Throughout history, often that's the way it happened. You made a political alliances by the way you married and intermarried your family. And so Ahab's father had his son Ahab married to Jezebel as a wise, really political alliance, bringing together two different kinds of kingdoms. When Jezebel comes in Israel, and Ahab and Jezebel come together, uniting these two kingdoms, she brings with her great enthusiasm for the worship of the gods in which her people worshipped. And so she brings that into Israel, and Ahab basically, you know, supports and sponsors much of what they call, you know, Baal worship. and things. There were shrines that were created. There was priests of Baal. The prophets of Israel were discarded or put down, and some of them killed. And then the prophets of Baal come in, and they're leading these religious observances around all of that. That's when Elijah steps into the scene. Got the context? Whether you wanted to or not, there you go. And Elijah comes in, and he says, he proclaims, God tells Elijah there's going to be a drought. And so you can think of Elijah's story in four scenes. And part of my purpose here is just to try to get this, some of this stuff in our brains. Four scenes. The first scene is the longest and most involved. The other three scenes are very brief. There's something we can glean from each scene, though. I'll do that in a moment. The first scene is about drought and a contest on a mountain, right? And then his fleeing and running away. He proclaims a drought. Now, Baal was known to be the god of rain, among other things. And so Elijah comes in and basically says that, you know, your god is no god, and therefore there's going to be a rain. And to demonstrate that Baal is no god, has no power over the rain at all, but the God of Israel does. And so he proclaims a drought. Well, he's affected by the drought too, because he lives there. And so he ends up by this creek, drinking water from the creek, and ravens come and feed him. So he's fed by ravens. And so on your card, when you leave today, as you pick up the card, that's actually the scene. There's a raven on his shoulder. It's in reference to that part of the story, when he's being fed by ravens. But as the drought goes on, the water dries up. And so God sends him somewhere else. And so he goes to this widow in Zarephath. And there she's picking up some sticks. Elijah goes to her and he says, please, can I have some food? And she says, she gives him some water. And she says, no, I'm picking up these sticks because all I have is one jar of meal and I only have a little bit of oil. I'm picking up these sticks that I might go home and build a fire with my son, have our last meal and die. And Elijah says, no, you will not die, but go and do what I ask you to do, and God will basically provide. So over the course of months and a couple of years, he stays there, she provides, the meal is not spent, and the jar is not emptied during the time that Elijah is there, and she is provided for. Her son ends up dying, he brings him to life, another part of the story. And then what happens is, near the end of the drought, Elijah then confronts the king, and he says, okay, I want you to get all the prophets of Baal. We're going to go to the mount, and we're going to see, indeed, who is God. And so there's 450 prophets of Baal, and there's Elijah. And he calls them together on Mount Carmel, and he says, okay, here is a bull, there is a bull. We're going to each sacrifice this animal, and we're going to each call upon our God. And the God who consumes this sacrifice by fire will be proven to be the true God. And so the prophets of Baal, they get their wood together, they put the bull on the altar, and they call from morning to noon, they cry out to Baal to come and consume the offering by fire. And nothing happens. And they cry out and they cut themselves and they go through all the rituals and nothing happens. And meanwhile, Elijah is taunting them. You know, where is your God? Has he gone to relieve himself? I mean, literally, is he gone? Where is he? And so he's taunting them. And then Elijah, when it's his turn, he gets 12 stones to represent the 12 tribes of Israel. And he puts the stones and makes an altar and puts wood on the altar and then puts the sacrifice on the altar. Then he digs a trench around the altar. And then he takes some water and he pours it over the offering. Then he takes some more water and he pours it over the offering. He pours so much water over the altar that it begins to puddle in the trench that he dug around it. Then he calls upon God and God consumes everything by fire. The whole offering, everything is consumed by fire. And prior to Elijah's prayer, he says to the people, he says to them, he says, how long will you go limping in two different opinions? How long will you go with a divided mind? He says, if Baal is God, serve Baal. If the Lord is God, serve him. And he calls upon God and the fire is consumes the offering. Then he has, as you heard our reading today, that's where we are now, the prophets of Baal are slaughtered, and Jezebel is not happy. She's not happy. Queen Jezebel says, the sun will not go down tomorrow before I do to Elijah, you know, I put him to death. And so Elijah, just after this confirmation that there is only God alone, and this wonderful demonstration of the Lord alone is God, he then flees. He finds himself under a broom tree, and he begs that God might end his life. He enters a period of deep depression, so bad that he wants his life to be over. And God says, no, no, Elijah. He says, the angel says, eat this. And then again, he sleeps and eat this. And then he goes on a 40-day, journey, 40-day, outward bound thing. He goes, hike. And he ends up at Mount Horeb. You know Mount Horeb? The north calls it Horeb. The south calls it something else, which you may know it by more. The south calls it Sinai. This is the mountain in which Moses encountered God, received the commandments. It's as if Elijah goes, and he's a prophet like Moses. He goes to the source itself, the place where the source of God's revelation is. And there he hides himself in a cave, and God appears to Moses, but God is not in the wind, and God is not in the earthquake, and God is not in the fire, but God is in the sheer silence of the moment. And Elijah receives a renewal and an extension of his call. That's scene one. Scene two will take about 3 minutes. Scene two, three, and four take about 3 minutes to give you. And you can read them this week. Scene two is a time in which Ahab now is desiring a vineyard that's right next to the palace. King wants the vineyard. You own the vineyard. Guess what? So he goes to Naboth, who owns the vineyard, and he offers a fair price. He didn't just take it. He offered to pay for it. He offered to, or give him a different one somewhere else. But Naboth got a problem. His problem is that this is his ancestral land. And so he feels like he would be betraying his ancestors, you know, if he was to let go of this land. This is the land that's entrusted to them from generation to generation. So he says no. And Ahab goes and sulks. And Jezebel said, what's your problem? You're the king. Do what you want. He says, I'll take care of it. And so she basically calls Naboth to a feast, and then they bring charges against Naboth that he has blasphemed against God, and he has subverted the king. And they take him out, and they stone him to death. Now the land reverts to the king. And Ahab now owns the vineyard. Well, turns out that in Israel, God's not very pleased with Ahab's behavior. Even though he's king, and in that ancient world, you think the king can do whatever the king wants to do. Not so. The king also is subject to God above. And so Elijah, tasked with the job to go confront the king and tell him and check his abuse of power. And so Elijah goes and he confronts the king and proclaims God's judgment upon what the king has done. He is a check. The prophet is a check against the abuse of power. And we see that throughout the prophetic literature, sometimes at great expense to the prophet himself. Scene three is a scene in which Elijah now is dealing with the son of Ahab, who's now king, Hazael. He's at the palace. He has an accident. He falls through some lattice. He's badly injured. He wants to know if he's going to live. And so he goes and he asks some of his servants to go to the gods of Ekron and find out if he's going to live or not. Elijah intercepts the folks and saying, is there no king? Is there no God in Israel? Why are you consulting foreign gods? He says, go tell the king he's not going to live. Right? And that he should be. And so he goes back, and that short story is the sense of, you know, the consulting of the God of Israel. Why is he consulting foreign gods? Scene four, Elijah is taken up to heaven in a whirlwind. And his successor is a guy that you get confused with Elijah, because his name is Elisha. Different guy. Elijah leaves his mantle. Elisha picks it up as he's carried off to heaven in a whirlwind, and he takes the mantle, passing the mantle, where we get that, and he strikes the Jordan River. It parts as Elijah did coming there. Elijah has received the spirit of Elijah, and then he carries up. That's next week, though. Getting ahead of myself. Drought, scene one. This vineyard scene with Naboth, scene two. The scene with Ahaziah consulting, scene three. Whirlwind, scene four. That's the story of Elijah. Three quick takeaways from scene one. Three C's to kind of nail that. I put them in your bulletin. Choose this day whom you will serve. That's the essence of the whole scene one. There is no God but God. And every generation, all of us, daily, have choices to make. And those choices are this way or that way, or they're God's way. And it's a daily kind of way. How long are we going to be torn between different opinions? How long are we going to be double-minded? Elijah the prophet brings clarity to the desire to follow God's way amongst all the ways that we could. The prophet is always bringing us back to what is God's will for this moment. And so we seek that every day. Choose this day to follow God. If we do, our life will be more abundant and fruitful. If we don't, even though we think we're choosing choices for ourselves, it doesn't work out very well. Choose this day whom you will serve. The second C from the second scene is to check the abuse of power. The prophetic role is always as a counterbalance against abuse of power, especially as power concentrates in any society in certain hands, in certain places, and tends to abuse the less powerful and the vulnerable. And the prophetic voice is always God's voice saying, even without having only the power of God's voice, saying, this is not right. We stand up to this injustice, and we speak against the power of the powers of the world that are not for those who are most vulnerable and exploited. Check the abuse of power. And the third C is to consult God on every decision. As Isaiah was consulting other things, Elijah comes and says, no, consult God, the one and only God, on every decision that we are to make. That's our role as prophetic people. And so may the life of Elijah be a resource in your own life. May you begin to seek, and may we begin to seek God's specific will for any moment of our lives. May we choose that way. May we be able to find ourselves also, you know, being an advocate of for God and for others, of those who sometimes are exploited. May we find ourselves consulting God on every decision that we make in life. Lord, thank you for your prophets, and thank you for our prophetic role as people as well. We seek to know and to live into your word for our time, in our place, in each circumstance. If you don't speak, we're lost. But if you speak and we can't discern it, we're still lost. So, Lord, give us ears to hear. Give us a community to respond. Enable us to live in the center of your will always. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we join together in our time of prayers and lift up those folks in our caring corner, I ask you to add to your prayers a longtime member of our church, Keith Tyler. Many of us knew Keith for years past, and he's been recently hospitalized in critical care at the Memorial, and Kaiser. And we know that he is in failing health, so we're going to be especially thinking about him this morning. Keith Tyler. Let us pray. Dear and gracious, glorious God, we give you thanks for this time to be together, to be a part of this church community who seeks to follow your word, who gathers for clarity in the wisdom of your ways. And we give you thanks for this summer's time, our lives turn to easier tasks and families gather around vacations, and others just feel the joy of the season. We ask you this morning as we lift our prayers to be with us in our vacation Bible school activities, such an important part in the lives of so many, many of us having been touched by the vacation Bible school times of our own childhood, and many of us have been involved both inspiring the young people but also learning from them. Give you thanks for the leaders in every corner of the world, for their willingness to step forward, to speak their truths, to carry us forward into the future. And we ask you to give us the courage, not only to stand with them, but to stand in front of them if we need to, so that we can speak our truths, perhaps in the face of their abuse of power. And on our caring corner, as we remember those who have asked for cares of health and healing, we also know there's others who haven't been lifted up, and some who we realize are lonely or depressed or afraid. So we ask you to be with especially all of those folks in your comfort and your grace. Let them know your presence. Dear God, in this moment of prayer, we seek that sheer silence where your still small voice resides. Help us carry expression to these thoughts, actions to the ideas of our hearts, and take this offering that we give now with your blessing as we seek to do your ministry in the world. Amen.
Lord, receive our offering as an expression of our thanksgiving and love for you. We thank you most of all for Jesus, your incarnate word among us, and for your spirit that speaks to us even this day. We pray in the name of Jesus and give thanks as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us go forth now to continue to choose to follow the Lord alone, to check on behalf of the poor and vulnerable the abuses of power, to consult God in every decision. We go with God's blessing, with God's grace and presence. Thanks be to God. Amen.